From Simon & Schuster Audio, Living Buddha, Living Christ, by Thich Nhat Hanh. Read by Ben Kingsley, with an introduction by Thich Nhat Hanh.
Ma nghiệp lặng thanh tịnh, gợi lòng theo tiếng chuông. In this program, I shall try to share some of my experiences of and insight into two beautiful flowers of the world, Buddhism and Christianity, so that we as a society can begin to dissolve our wrong perceptions, transcend our wrong views, and see one another in fresh new ways. If we can enter the 21st century with this spirit of mutual understanding and acceptance, our children and their children will surely benefit. A year ago in Florence, a Catholic priest told me that he was interested in learning more about Buddhism. I asked him to share with me his understanding of the Holy Spirit, and he replied, "The Holy Spirit is the energy sent by God." His statement touched me deeply. It confirmed my feeling that the safest way to approach the Trinity is through the door of the Holy Spirit. In Buddhism, our effort is to practice mindfulness in each moment, to know what is going on within and all around us. When the Buddha was asked, "Sir, what do you and your monks practice?" he replied, "We sit, we walk, and we eat." The questioner continued, "But sir, everyone sits, walks, and eats." And the Buddha told him, "When we sit, we know we are sitting. When we walk, we know we are walking. When we eat, we know we are eating." Most of the time, we are lost in the past or carried away by future projects and concerns. When we are mindful, touching deeply the present moment, we can see and listen deeply, and the fruits are always understanding, acceptance, love, and the desire to relieve suffering and bring joy. To me, mindfulness is very much like the Holy Spirit. Both are agents of healing. When you have mindfulness, you have love and understanding, you see more deeply, and you can heal the wounds in yourself. The Buddha was called the King of Healers in the Bible. When someone touches Christ, he or she is healed. It is not just touching a cloth that brings about miracle. When you touch deep understanding and love, you are healed. The Holy Spirit descended on Jesus like a dove, penetrated him deeply, and he became the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Jesus healed whatever he touched. With the Holy Spirit in him, his power as a healer transformed many people. All schools of Christianity agree on this. I told the priest that I felt that all of us also have the seed of the Holy Spirit in us, the capacity of healing, transforming, and loving. When we touch that seed, we are able to touch also God the Father and God the Son. Let's continue.
When Thich Nhat Hanh was a young monk in Vietnam, each village temple had a big bell, like those in Christian churches in Europe and America. Whenever the bell was invited to sound, In Buddhist circles, we never say hit or strike a bell. All the villagers would stop what they were doing and pause for a few moments to breathe in and out in mindfulness. At Plum Village, the Sangha, or community of practice where Thich Nhat Hanh lives in France, we do the same. Every time we hear the bell, we go back to ourselves and enjoy our breathing. Breathing in, we say, silently, listen, listen. And breathing out, we say, this wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. Ben Kingsley continues.
20 years ago, at a conference of theologians and professors of religion, an Indian Christian friend told the assembly, "We are going to discuss many traditions, but we're not going to make a fruit salad." When it came my turn to speak, I said, "Fruit salad can be delicious. I have shared the Eucharist with Father Daniel Berrigan, and our worship became possible because of the sufferings we Vietnamese and Americans shared over many years." Some of the Buddhists present were shocked to hear that I had participated in the Eucharist, and many Christians seemed truly horrified. To me, religious life is life. I do not see any reason to spend one's whole life tasting just one kind of fruit. We human beings can be nourished by the best values of many traditions. Professor HANH'S Kung has said, "Until there is peace between religions, there can be no peace in the world. People kill and are killed because they cling too tightly to their own beliefs and ideologies. When we believe that ours is the only faith that contains the truth, violence and suffering will always be the result." The second precept of the Order of Interbeing, founded within the Zen Buddhist tradition during the war in Vietnam, is about letting go of views. It reminds us, do not think the knowledge you presently possess is changeless, absolute truth. Avoid being narrow-minded and bound to present views. Learn and practice non-attachment from views in order to be open to receive others' viewpoints. To me, this is the most essential practice of peace. During the war in Vietnam, I saw communists and anti-communists killing and destroying each other because each side believed that they had a monopoly on the truth. Many Christians and Buddhists in our country were fighting each other instead of working together to stop the war. In 1966, I came to North America to try to dissolve some of the wrong views that were at the root of the war. I met with hundreds of individuals and small groups, and also with members of Congress and Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara. The visit was organized by the Fellowship of Reconciliation, an interfaith peace organization, and many active Christians helped me in these efforts, among them Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Father Thomas Merton, and Father Daniel Berrigan. These were, in fact, the Americans I found it easiest to communicate with. But my path to discovery of Jesus as one of my spiritual ancestors was not easy. The colonization of Vietnam by the French was deeply connected with the efforts of Christian missionaries. In the late 17th century, Alexandre de Rhodes, one of the most active of the missionaries, wrote of the Buddha, "Just as when a cursed, barren tree is cut down, the branches that are still on it will also fall, when the sinister and deceitful Shakya is defeated, the idolatrous fabrications that proceed from him will also be destroyed." In the late 1950s and early 1960s, Archbishop Ngo Dinh Thuc, in his efforts to evangelize Vietnam, leaned heavily on the political power of his brother, President Ngo Dinh Diem. President Diem's 1963 decree, prohibiting the celebration of Vesak, the most important Buddhist national holiday, was the straw that broke our back. Tens of thousands of lay and ordained Buddhists demonstrated for religious freedom, leading to a coup d'etat and the overthrow of the Diem regime. In such an atmosphere of discrimination and injustice against non-Christians, it was difficult for me to discover the beauty of Jesus' teachings. But through friendships with Christian men and women who truly embody the spirit of understanding and compassion, I have been able to touch the depths of Christianity. The moment I met Martin Luther King, Jr., for example, I knew I was in the presence of a holy person. Not just his good work, but his very being was a source of great inspiration for me. On the altar in my hermitage in France are images of Buddha and Jesus, and every time I light incense, I touch both of them as my spiritual ancestors. I can do this because of contact with real Christians like Dr. King. When you touch someone who authentically represents a tradition, you not only touch his or her tradition, you also touch your own. This quality is essential for dialogue. In a true dialogue, we allow the good, the beautiful, and the meaningful in the other's tradition to transform us. But any dialogue must begin with oneself. If we do not know how to make peace within, how can we hope to bring about peace in the world? That is why the practice of meditation, looking deeply, is so important. We must recognize and accept the conflicting elements within us and their underlying causes. It takes time, but the effort always bears fruit. When we have peace within, real dialogue with others is possible. In the Psalms, it says, "Be still and know that I am God." Be still means to become peaceful and concentrated. The Buddhist term is shamatha, which means stopping, calming, concentrating. To know means to acquire wisdom, insight, or understanding. The Buddhist term is vipassana, insight, or looking deeply. Looking deeply means observing something or someone with so much concentration that the distinction between observer and observed disappears. The result is always insight into the true nature of the object. When we look into the heart of a flower, we see clouds, sunshine, minerals, time, the earth, and everything else in the cosmos in it. Without clouds, there could be no rain, and there would be no flower. Without time, the flower could not bloom. In fact, the flower is made entirely of non-flower elements. It has no independent individual existence. It inter-is with everything else in the universe. Inter-being is a new word, but I believe it will be in the dictionary soon. When we see the nature of inter-being, barriers between ourselves and others are dissolved, and peace, love, and understanding are possible. Just as a flower is made only of non-flower elements, Buddhism is made only of non-Buddhist elements, including Christian ones, and Christianity is made of non-Christian elements, including Buddhist ones. We have different roots, traditions, and ways of seeing, but we share the common qualities of love, understanding, and acceptance. For our dialogue to be open, we need to open our hearts, set aside our prejudices, listen deeply, and represent truthfully what we know and understand. Touching deeply is an important practice. We touch with our hands, our eyes, our ears, and also with our mindfulness. The first practice I learned as a novice monk was to breathe in and out consciously, to touch each breath with my mindfulness, identifying the in-breath as in-breath and the out-breath as out-breath, while making an effort to quiet my thoughts. When you practice this way, your mind and body come into alignment, and you're at your best. Mindfulness is the substance of a Buddha. When you enter deeply into this moment, you see the nature of reality, and this insight liberates you from suffering and confusion. Peace is already there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.